Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, my dear brothers and my sisters. Carry on the prophetic narratives on the preserved tablets. And I just want to say about the chain of narratives here, carry on about where we left and what we said about the hadith of the five conditions. When it comes to the chain of narratives, sometimes you hear a sheikh or somebody says that this hadith has got a strong chain of narratives or a authentic chain of narratives or weak chain of narratives and things like that. What do they mean by that? Well, if the hadith only fulfills three conditions, that all narrators and at each step of the generations, they must be good of character, must act justly in their day-to-day life, they have great precision and fallible memory in what they are narrating, and they have a continuous link between the narrators from the beginning to the end, but the content of the hadith has not been checked. So what they tell you is, the chain of narrators is authentic, or it's good, or it's this, so we can guarantee you just the chain of narrators, but the content itself, we don't guarantee it. And this is a deceptive trick, vile trick that they play on you. This hadith is isnaduhu jayyid. It's a very good, strong chain of narrator. But what they tell you is, we can't guarantee the content inside. And what does it make the hadith strong is that they fulfill the two other conditions, that the hadith must be free from any oddness in the chain of the content, and that the content itself does not contradict anything else. Needless to say that these rules, the five rules, are only good on paper, because each scholar of hadith has a way of looking at things from different angles. The school of thought, the political inclination, the desires, orientations, the time, the people where they lived, all these affect the hadith. And depending on which narrators the person, the scholar trusts, a hadith can change the degree of authenticity just like that. If I like that narrator, then his hadith in my eyes is good, the hadith is authentic, and it becomes a religion for us. Of course, needless to say that the majority of prophetic narrations haven't been checked against the Quran, hadith of Allah, the true speech of Allah. And this has created countless contradictions, so much so that in order for the prophetic narrations to work, the Quran must be put on shelves. And this is exactly what has happened for the last 14 centuries, and this is where we are today. We have a parallel Islam based on prophetic narrations. While the Quran is sent away on a long hike, regardless of what is being said today, when you hear the Salafists say, we follow the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger with the understanding of the companions, it should be we follow the Book of Allah according to us, because Allah is alive, the Quran is alive, and Allah talks to us alive. I don't need to understand Islam for that, or math with the minds of people that have died. They had their time, they had their vision, they have their conditions, circumstances, that's good for them. For us today, Islam is for me as an alive person. It's very important that you keep this in mind. Okay? But anyhow, scholars agree that if a hadith is 100% authentic, all it means is that scholars have a reasonable doubt that the messenger might have said it or said something close to it. But it is in no way a guarantee that this narration actually comes from the messenger as we hear it or is written in the books of hadith. Even though in the books that they teach, in the books that they write, they say this, scholars, sheikhs, preachers, and anyone else always tells you that the hadith is 100% from the messenger of Allah. And this is one part. The second part, and this part really disturbs me great deal, and it goes to show that we Muslims truly do not use what Allah gifted us with, and that is the mighty brain. This part, they always tell you that the hadith, the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is a wahi, it's a revelation. Okay, it is. Let's assume it is a revelation. The prophetic narrations are a revelation. So why aren't they included in the Quran? And that's it. It's all good and dandy, right? But to understand this concept, let's first study the three big elements that form al-Islam. One of which is a narration from Allah, a wahi, a revelation, two of which are not. Let's start with the Quran. The Quran from Allah, both words and meanings. The Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has no hand in it, except that he reported it to us. That's it. He received it by Jibreel alayhi salam, and since the Quran is a compilation of elements that will guide humanity to their God, to the Lord, and then to the pleasure of Allah, the entire humanity till judgment day can comprehend, understand, and be guided by the Quran. It was left after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam without any explanation or commentary by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Al-Islam was perfected at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not dictate a book to explain the Quran. He never did that. Anything that tells you that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said about this and that is a pure lie. Because humanity, as known by Allah, will progress as we are today. And the Quran, the beauty of this book is that it is authored in such manner that a farmer can live happy with it, a scientist can live happy with it, a NASA astronaut can live happy with it, and an ocean diver can live happy with it, either today or a billion years from now. So that's Al-Quran. Part number two is what they call the Hadith Qudsi, or that translates into a sanctified speech, or a speech that is sanctified. This is a funny one, really. It makes me laugh, because they say that the Hadith, the sanctified speech, or the sanctified Hadith, is any Hadith where the wordings are from the Prophet, but the meanings are from Allah. So the Messenger receives the meanings from Allah, and Allah leaves it to the Messenger to tell us what Allah wants to say. As if Allah hadn't said enough in Al-Quran, and He wanted to tell us more. Subhanallah. But anyhow, that's why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they say, I don't believe in it split of a second, but they say that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam always starts this type of narrations or narratives by saying, Allah said, or your Lord said, and did you know what your Lord said, and so on and so forth. A sanctified hadith is named so because this is a type of hadith or saying that is considered a direct message from Allah, revealed to the Prophet in the meaning to him by Almighty Allah, and all that it needed to do was for the messenger to tell us that it is from Allah. It is also important to realize here that this type of hadith, the sanctified message, is not brought to us or to the messenger by Jibreel. It's a direct link between the Prophet and Allah, which makes it far more important, more authentic than the Quran, because the Quran is brought by Jibreel. But the sanctified hadith is direct between him and Allah. It's three or two. You see how? You see the problems we have? That's why we Muslims, 1400 years later, we're still confused and nowhere to see in the truth, really, because Al-Quran is the book we should be following hand down. There is nothing else to dispute this, but other people, scholars are, and institutions are pushing on us external elements that are clouding our vision. Our relationship with the Quran is so much clouded that I tell people, Allah says in the Quran, they say, but the hadith says. So that's how shirk comes in. Is when I tell you Allah says in the Quran and you tell me the hadith says that. Then we have the third type, and that is the prophetic narration. Things that they said, the messenger said, and as I said earlier on, they attach to it the saying, the doing, and the agreement or disagreement. And they say that the words are from the messenger, but the meaning is from Allah. So what's the difference between this and the sanctified hadith? They say, oh, no. There's a disagreement between the scholars about the sanctified hadith. It's actually the meanings and the words, but they're not Quran, and you get in a headache. However, but anyhow, we go back to here that they say the hadith is a revelation from Allah, and the Rasulullah does as commanded, acts as commanded, and all that kind of stuff. My question is this. If these prophetic hadith, or hadith as you say, narrations, are regarded as a revelation from Allah, why don't we just say Allah says, just like we said for the Quran, right? The Quran comes from Allah to Jibreel to the messenger. Okay? And we still say, Allah says. Now the hadith comes from Allah to the messenger. Why do we say the messenger said? If it's a revelation, let's say it comes from Allah and the whole headache. We never ever hear the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, Allah says, do this or do that. He always says, I said, because as you read the Quran, it always is, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنْ قُلْ, and they ask you about say, and at times that is not even they ask you about this, the Prophet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala straight away answers on behalf of the messenger, قُلْ, say. Now that you have a better idea about the prophetic narrations, let us see what the reported sayings attributed to the messenger of Allah about the preserved tablets, about the Lawh al-Mahfoodh. What has he really said? Now, many hadith that you, whatever book you take and whatever you do that, mention that Allah at some point in the far distance past created a pen. Then, and they call it in Arabic al-Qalam al-Azam, the high pen and things like that. Then after the pen, they say, our scholars, that Allah created the tablet, al-Lawh al-Mahfoodh, the preserved tablet. And in that tablet, the pen wrote everything that is to happen until the end of time. Our scholars differ, however, about which was created first, the pen or the water or the arsh, the throne, altogether. And this is a famous debate still alive and lives till today, and I will deal with it later on, inshallah. First creation in the Quran. What does Allah say about the first creation? Allah has made it explicitly clear. In Surah Hud, that is Surah number 11, ayah number 7, He says, وَهُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَّامٍ. And He, i.e. Allah, is the one who created the heavens and the earth in 6 days. And 6 days are the periods, not like in the Torah, Judaism, it's Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, no. The 6 days, it's a period of time. And Allah says, وَكَانَ عَرْشُهُ عَلَى الْمَاءِ, and His arsh, oftentimes translated as throne, when in fact it does not mean that, but this is not the point of discussing that. So, was upon the water. So Allah says, عَرْشُهُ, the arsh of Allah, was upon the water. And as I said, even though the scholars hold different views on the meaning of the word arsh, but I will deal with this later on. But for now, all we need to know is that when Allah mentions about the creation, He explicitly mentions that the arsh and the water were there before the creations of heaven and earth. Our books of old and present mention that the pen is the third creation after the arsh. So what they said is, there is the arsh, there is the water, then Allah created the pen, then Allah created the preserved tablet, al-Lawh al-Mahfoodh. For your information, all this is 100% assumption and speculations. They have no proof whatsoever for that, especially the preserved tablets. And I will get back to the pen when I deal next week, inshallah, about the what kind of writings has Allah written, and we get to deal with does the prayers, the dua we make, alter the qadr, and all that kind of stuff. Okay? Then they hold the view, as I said, that the preserved tablet is either above the arsh or below the arsh. Again, they have, like, it's unbelievable. Allah wrote in the preserved tablet is not enough. Now they need to situate it. Is it above the arsh? And of course, in the Salafist world, Allah is seated like you would sit on a chair on the arsh. If they say the tablet is above the arsh, it means it's above Allah. And this is it's unbelievably wrong, because Allah says in the Quran, سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى. سَبِّحْ is سَبِّحْ اسْمَ الْأَعْلَى is the most high. Nothing is higher than Allah. Other they say, no, you got it all wrong, guys. اللوح المحفوظ, the preserved tablet, is under the arsh. That's why they tell you this one is taken from the arsh of Allah, underneath the arsh. And now you find all this, they are vile. What our scholars have done is really, really vile, and we're paying the price of that today. Okay, but anyhow, so has Allah mentioned the pen in the Quran that He wrote everything? No, He did not mention any of that. And how can the pen, Allah commands the pen write, and the pen starts writing by itself? Now the question is, when the pen starts writing by itself, did it suddenly become extremely knowledgeable? Does it carry the knowledge of Allah? If it does, then it becomes equal to Allah in that knowledge, and this is not true. And if Allah has put, it makes your brain boil, really. It really does. But anyway, let's see what these people have invented to convince us that what they're saying is correct, because Rasulullah has not spoken this kind of calamities. They say that Ahmed, Abu Dawood, At-Tirmidhi, that Ubadah ibn Samit, Allah praise you them, is to have said that the Messenger of Allah said, okay, this is what they say, the hadith is authentic, Al-Albani authenticated, and everybody has authenticated this hadith. أول ما خلق الله القلم, the first of what Allah created was the pen. ثم قال اكتب, then Allah told the pen, write. In the pen, kindly and nicely said, and then the pen, Allah commanded him, write that is to happen until the day of judgment. And this is, it says, فَكَتَبَ فَجَرَى بِمَا هُوَ كَائِنٌ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. So Allah told him, اكتب, and the pen started running, writing everything to happen till the day of resurrection. This is a dangerous statement. And what happens after the day of resurrection? Has it been written or not? If it has not been written, why is Allah telling us all what's going to happen after the judgment day and what we're going to find in Jannah? Hasn't Allah decided to create that? But anyway, in Abu Dawood's version, it reads a little bit different. إِنَّ أَوَّلَ مَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ الْقَلَمُ فَقَالَ لَهُ اكْتُبْ. The first thing that Allah created was the pen. And he said to it, write. And the pen asked it, وَمَاذَا أَكْتُبْ. And what should I write, my Lord? Then Allah says, اكْتُبْ مَقَدِيرَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى تَقُومَ السَّاعَةِ. Write the decree or the quantity of all that is to happen till the hour happens. And this type of saying is extremely dangerous, because it is telling us that Allah's knowledge is shared with a pen. That the pen at one point knew exactly what Allah knows. And what's the purpose of knowing it when Allah, and if Allah has already documented everything? If you hide a pair of socks somewhere in your house, you hid it. And then you tell me, oh, I know everything. I know the unseen. And I go, really? And you go, look, I know where exactly a pair of socks is. And then you go and dig it out from under the bed. Am I going to go, wow, you actually know the unseen? I'm completely amazed with that. I'm impressed, right? Well, if Allah has written everything, what's the big deal about him knowing the unseen? He already wrote it. What's the purpose of writing, being knowledgeable about it? What's the big deal? You see what I mean? It's to make fun of Allah. Allah has not written the unseen, that's why he knows it. Allah has not written what you are going to do, that's why he is a God, because he has not decided what you're gonna do, he has not written for you what you're gonna do, guess what? But he knows what you're gonna do. He knows what your choices are. You understand what I mean? It's extremely delicate, this problem, and they make it seem as if it's nothing. Another hadith in Sahih Muslim this time, and the hadith is again adds another extra parameter to the whole creation business. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As. So this one is Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As. And Abdullah is one of the four great scholars. They call them the four Abadila. Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As. One of the great people. Also, he is, subhanAllah, this man, Abdullah ibn Amr, is the only companion that wrote down what he heard from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the majority of scholars of Islam has disregarded what he wrote and considered him as a weak narrators, because they relied on memory and they refused what was written down. Don't you? It's very, very strange, these people. But anyhow, I'll save that to the hadith. Talking to myself here. And he said that he heard Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول, كتب الله مقادير الخلائق قبل أن يخلق السماوات والأرض بخمسين ألف سنة. Allah wrote the measures, calculations of the creations 50,000 years before he created the heavens and the earth. قال, and then he added, وعرشه على الماء, and his throne, as I said, the arsh of Allah, upon water. Notice that so far there is no mention of Lawh Mahfoodh whatsoever, except the pen wrote and that's that. There is no Lawh Mahfoodh, there is no preserved tablets, we don't even know where the pen wrote, on a tree, on a piece of paper, on water, on the side of the hash, I don't know where he wrote, but it doesn't say at all a preserved tablet. And then there is another issue with this hadith, the date of 50,000 years. How did this number come about, especially that Allah didn't and hadn't as yet created time? So how comes the messenger tells us that 50,000 years without time being into existence from the start in the first beginning? Anyway, in a narrative in Al-Bukhari, another companion named Imran ibn Husayn said that some tribes came from Al-Yemen and these people came to seek knowledge. And they told, it's a long hadith, but the introduction is this. And then these people from Al-Yemen, they say, جِئْنَاكَ لِنَتَفَقَّ فِي الدِّينِ يَا مَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, we came to you seeking knowledge about this religion of Islam. وَلِنَسْأَلَكَ عَنْ أَوَّلِ هَذَا الْأَمْرِ, and also to ask you about how it all began, creation and all that. And then they say, and I don't believe in this, that Rasulullah ﷺ said, كَانَ اللَّهُ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْءٌ قَبْلَهُ. In another, في لفظ آخر, معه, وفي لفظ ثالث, غيره. They said, Ya Rasulullah, so we came to seek knowledge and also ask how it all started. And they say, that he answered, there was Allah and there was nothing before him. In another narration, they say, he said that there was Allah and there was nothing with him. In the third narration, they say that he said that there was Allah and there was nothing but him. As you can see, we have so many different versions. We have become like Christians, you know. Different versions of the Bible, we have different versions of the Hadith. They have four canonical books, Matthew, John, and all that, and Lucas, and all that kind of stuff. And you have the four school of thoughts, and so on and so forth. But anyhow, and then they added, وَكَانَ عَرْشُهُ عَلَى الْمَاءِ, and his throne was over the water. And then this extra bit is interesting. وَكَتَبَ فِي الذِّكْرِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ وَخَلَقَ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, and he wrote all things in the dhikr. Rasulullah ﷺ did not mention the preserved tablets. He mentioned, as in Al-Quran, in this part of the hadith, the word dhikr. And the dhikr is different than the book. Please go back to the previous talks when I speak about the dhikr and what it means there. And then he said, and he created the heavens and the earth. And in another again narration, ثُمَّ خَلَقَ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, then he created the heavens and the earth. And to push the meanings of Lawh Mahfoodh, the preserved tablets concept, the commentators and those scholars that explained the Bukhari, Muslim, and this and that, all they did was put Lawh Mahfoodh, and they kept using it one time after the other, so that it gets cemented into your mind and in my mind. You know, when you lie to yourself the same lie so many times, you start believing in it, and that's exactly what happened. Even though Allah spoke in the Quran about a dhikr, Rasulullah spoke about a dhikr, and a dhikr in the Quran is always referred to the book of Allah or the Torah given to Moses. It's either the Torah or the Quran, and I'll get back to it later on in the next talk. Inshallah, I want to speak about what Allah has written, the language in what He's written, what can we do with what He has written. So as you can see here, and to make people, as I say, believe in this, they bring Al-Quran. وَلَقَدْ كَتَبْنَا فِي الزَّابُورِ مِنْ بَعْدِ الذِّكْرِ, and we have written in the Psalms given to David alayhi salam, and after the dhikr, they said the dhikr is preserved tablets, and I have already explained this, and I say this is a lie, because the dhikr here is the Torah given to Moses, i.e. Allah has written in the Psalms given to David, after he has written it in the Torah, that the earth shall be inherited by my righteous subservience. إِنَّ الْأَرْضَ يَرِثُهَا عِبَادِيَ الصَّالِحُونَ. But this is again the manipulation of the scholars to push on us something of their political in debates and school of thoughts, arguments and differences back in time. They wrote it in such a way, and we are still struggling and suffering with these kind of things. As a conclusion, even though the term Lawh Mahfoodh, the preserved tablets, as is presented to us these days, as people believe, is it non-stoppingly, incessantly, they believe that the Lawh Mahfoodh is something that carries all our actions, things like that. Actually, it was never directly or explicitly mentioned by the Quran, or in the Quran, or the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and being sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the instruction, the teacher, and all that kind of stuff, he never ever uttered that our deeds or everything that is to happen is written in the preserved tablet. So after all this journey, where does this leave us? And the question to ask is, has Allah written for us our lives ahead of time, or has He not? If He has not written or decided our life for us, then we need not carry on this conversation, and that's it. But the Quran is telling us that Allah has indeed written. So the question comes in, what has He written? Is it according to that big lie hadith that the angel comes in and writes four things about your life and things like that? Of course not. So what has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala written? This is what we shall see, inshallah, the upcoming talk about what has Allah written and how can that affect our lives, and how can we deal with what Allah has written. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that now we have a better understanding about this issue of Lawh Mahfoodh, and that nothing of that kind of your life is designed and already set for you. A concept exists out there. You're free on earth to create, to be as good as much as you want, or as vile and evil as much as you want, knowing that on judgment day you'll be held responsible over the choices you made in this life, and you cannot come on judgment day and tell to Allah, you decided for me and I only followed the pathway of what you have written. It cannot be used on your for you on judgment day. It will be used against you. So until the next talk, inshallah, about what Allah has written and the knowledge of Allah and things like that, I leave you with the protection of Allah. Again, this is your brother Abdusalam Abu Hanifa, the same yada yada at the end. If you want to join my group, please just send me a message on WhatsApp group. The number is 07876408735. If you don't want to do that, just subscribe to my YouTube channel, Islam Pep Talk. You've got like around 200 talks there in a variety of topics that will help you see clear and actually love al-Islam and appreciate the book of Allah and feel good in your skin as you are meant to do. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.